Keith Gibbs from Western Carolina University, benthic macroinvertebrate biofilm response to antimycin during brook trout.
Hello, everybody. Can you see my screen okay and hear me?
We're good.
Okay, great. Well, thank you for having me and for hosting this colloquium. Again, my name is Keith Gibbs and I am at Western Carolina University. I did start this work when I was at my previous institution, which is Tennessee Tech University, with Justin Murdoch, and while we were advising our graduate student, Aiden Blackburn. So this is the culmination of that work over the last 5 years. We did complete our work last year, and it is looking at the response of benthic macroinvertebrates and periphyton to a brook trout restoration project that was conducted by the Fisheries Division, Matt Colt, and the folks in the Fisheries Division using a piscicide antimycin, which I'll get to in a little bit more detail in just a minute. But first, I wanted to touch on why there's a need for restoration in the first place. So you can see in the top right here, this is an image of a brook trout. So it is our only native salmonid, native trout species to the eastern U.S. But as Andrew pointed out, we have had a complex history in the Smokies and really throughout the Appalachians as a whole. And you can see what we enjoy today was not quite as pristine as it is today in the past because of various activities. There was extensive logging throughout the Appalachians and other activities that ultimately reduced stream water quality and reduced native brook trout populations. That in conjunction with overfishing resulted in folks stocking non-native species, in particular rainbow trout and brown trout, into these waters, displacing many of the native brook trout that were left, and that is still the case in many streams today. So as part of the Park Service mission to maintain and restore native species, this is an effort in this regard to restore a brook trout population in one of the local streams, Little Caloochee Creek, which I'll get to here in just a minute. But I do want to talk about antimycin first. So it is a piscicide. There are several piscicides out there. The two most common are rotenone and antimycin. In this application, antimycin is certainly the preferred piscicide because it is more effective in cold water systems like we have in the Smokies. Unlike rotenone, it is not detectable by fish, so they can't evade the toxicant when they're exposed to it. It's uptaken by their gills and ultimately breaks down cellular respiration, so starving them, their cells of ATP over time. But when it is administered into an aquatic system, it does break down rather quickly. It's derived from a soil bacteria, and it's a fairly large molecule. So once it interacts with organic material and exposed to UV light, it does start to break down pretty quickly. And based on previous research throughout the country and multiple studies in the Smokies, it does have minimal effect to non-target taxa, including aquatic macroinvertebrates, predominantly juvenile stages of insects. And there have been a few studies that have looked at periphyton or biofilm, but we wanted to confirm some of those previous results. And there are established protocols that Matt and others in the park have helped develop, and that's ultimately the protocols that they follow. So again, this project occurred in the Little Caloochee Creek. So this was a restoration effort that occurred in fall of 2017. And you can see here, the watershed as a whole is located in the eastern part of the park on the North Carolina side. And the way that this watershed is structured, we ultimately were able to have sites established within the treatment area. So that's Little Caloochee Creek and its tributaries. So the Fisheries Division did determine the extent of rainbow trout distribution, and that's ultimately where they decided that their treatment would end. And that was included multiple tributaries to Little Kettleachy Creek. And as you can see here, we did establish 4 sampling sites within the treatment area. And there was an adjacent subwatershed, Corral Branch, where we established 4 reference sites, or these functioned as our controls. And we chose these sites based on similar elevation and other stream characteristics to really represent a counterpart to the treatment area. So before any stream is restored, there's plenty of work that goes in beforehand. And one of the first things is to determine, is there a sufficient barrier to prevent these non-native trout from moving back upstream after it's been restored? And that's this picture here. It's depicted by this little black line. And you can see, so this is, it's hard to tell in the scale, but these are very large logs. This is probably about a 6-foot waterfall. So it is an effective barrier to prevent non-native species, in this case mostly or all rainbow trout, from re-invading the treated zone after they completed their treatment. And just downstream of the confluence between Corral Branch and Little Cataloochee Creek, we established a 9th site, and this was a site to monitor the effects of the detoxifying agent, which in this case is potassium permanganate. So because of federal regulations, when this antimycin is administered into an aquatic water body, it does have to be detoxified. And at this point, potassium permanganate is the agent that is used to do that. So we did establish a site below that detoxification to monitor the effects of that as well. And you can see on this timeline here, so we did start collecting macroinvertebrates in 2015, so in the fall of 2015, and concluded our sampling in the fall of 2019. And we sampled yearly between the treatment, which did occur in September 2017. And you can see in this expanded timeline here, we also increased our frequency of sampling during the month pre and post treatment, and with samples collected also 1 week before and 1 week after, and then 1 day after as well. During this shorter bracketed period, this is also where we collected periphyton data as well to monitor the biofilm response. So when we were in the field at each one of our sites, we did collect water quality, standard water quality measurements, dissolved oxygen, pH, conductivity, and temperature. We also collected 3 replicate HESS samples. So this is a HESS sampler down here, and this does allow you to quantitatively sample the benthos for macroinvertebrates. And then we also took 3 replicates for periphyton. In essence, we scrubbed rocks with toothbrushes, collected all of the material, filtered that material, and then analyzed those back at the lab for total organic matter, as well as chlorophyll for a proxy to the photosynthetic algae that were present on in that biofilm. And again, this was conducted during that truncated time period with 1 month pre-treatment to 1 month post-treatment. For all of our univariate data, we used mixed models to determine any significant differences over time. And for our multivariate data, we used several methods, ordination, analysis of similarity, and some Simper functions to determine how those assemblages changed. For our univariate data, again, specifically in this case, the total periphyton organic matter, which we used ash-free dry mass as the proxy for. You can see here the dashed line indicates when treatment occurred. The orange bars are the treatment sites, blue bars are controls, And then the gray are the detoxification sites. And you could see that based on this asterisk here, there was a significant difference 1 day post-treatment. And looking at this bar graph, you can see there is a difference between the treatment and the controls, but relative to pre-treatment, there really was more of an increase in those control and detox sites. So that's probably an indication of just natural variation, but comparing 1 week pre-treatment to 1 day post, there was a slight decline. But then within 1 week post-treatment, everything was comparable again and there was no significant difference. When we looked at the algal constituent, so again, we used chlorophyll concentration as the proxy for this. And you could see that we did have significant differences 1 day post and 1 week post. And again, similar to the total organic matter, it was really more of a result of increases, probably just from natural variation and sampling variation in our control and our detox sites relative to our treatment sites. But if we look at the trend across all time for all of these, there was a slight increase over time, over that 1 month period, in total chlorophyll in all of our sites. And this makes sense. This was in fall. So leaves were falling off trees, canopy cover was opening. So that was allowing more sunlight to come through and ultimately promoting photosynthesis. So in all, there was very little, if any effect, negative effect on the periphyton as a result of antimycin or potassium permanganate. When we looked at our macroinvertebrate assemblages, we did compare multivariate data first. So looking at the assemblages as a whole, and as we saw in Ben's talk this morning, this is an ordination technique. This is non-metric multidimensional scaling. And all of these ordination techniques, what they do is help you visualize similarity and differences between your data. So in this instance, all of our samples were compared and collapsed into 1 point per sample period. So the closer 2 points are, the more similar they are, the more distant they are, the more dissimilar. And you could see based on the bold lines connecting the control and treatment sites at those various time periods that 1 week post-treatment and 1 month post-treatment were where we saw our significant differences at that assemblage level. And no other time period relative to itself, its counterpart, was significantly different. And again, this is control versus antimycin exposure. We see a similar result in control versus the detoxification. So the significant time periods that were different were 1 week and 1 month post-treatment. When we get into details a little bit more and look at what is driving those differences at the taxonomic order level, the two orders that were most affected were the mayflies, so order Ephemeroptera, and stoneflies, order Plecoptera, and we'll get into those results in a minute. But by far, the mayflies had the most substantial impact from antimycin and potassium permanganate, and the most prolonged effect. So you can see we did have, we saw a decline 1 day post-treatment in the detoxification site, and then that continued for 1 week, 1 month, and even 1 year post-treatment. However, in the treatment area, so antimycin exposure, there was a delayed effect, but we did see a decrease in 1 week, 1 month post, but then after 1 year post, and then certainly 2 years post, there were those assemblages, or those genera were comparable to our control sites again. We saw a similar trend in the stoneflies, the order Plecoptera, and you could see that delayed effect 1 week and 1 month post. But again, by 1 year and definitely by 2 years post, everything was back to normal. I did want to point out, so the other order of aquatic stages of insects that is most sensitive are the caddisflies, so the order Trichoptera. With Trichoptera and the other major aquatic orders, specifically Coleoptera, the beetles, and Diptera, the true flies, we did not see a negative impact from either antimycin or potassium permanganate throughout the course of the study. So just to summarize our results, antimycin, if it had an effect on the biofilm, the periphyton, it was short-lived, less than 1 week. So no substantial effects there. However, with the macroinvertebrate assemblages, we did see those effects, those delayed effects from 1 week and 1 month post-treatment from both antimycin and potassium permanganate. Again, we followed this up with a simper function, which allowed us to identify which species were driving those differences. And you could see there were three genera of mayflies, Ephemeroptera, so Stenonema, Betis, and Urolophella, as well as one genera of stonefly, Paraleuctra. So those declines in those four genera ultimately resulted in those differences that we saw in 1 week and 1 month post-treatment. And as I've mentioned, potassium permanganate, so the detoxification actually had the greatest and most prolonged effect. However, everything was comparable, if not immediately, at least within 1 to 2 years post-treatment. So what does this mean overall for management and ecological implications? Antimycin is very effective at removing non-native species. That's been proven multiple times at this point, including multiple projects in the Smokies. And the negative effects on non-target organisms are very short-lived. We do advise continuing to sample pre and post-treatment for aquatic macroinvertebrates and potentially other organisms such as salamanders, just to determine if there is a negative effect. And if possible, finding an alternate detoxicant to reduce the effects that we saw from that. And lots of folks to thank. Without the Park Service, without the Fisheries Division, and all of the administrators, this work would not have been completed. Tennessee Tech did provide the substantial amount of funding to support Aiden and his work, which would not have been, this project would not have been completed without him. And obviously I want to thank Western for the opportunity today to share our small part in this study about restoring this economically and ecologically important species. And with that, I don't know if I have time for questions, but I will certainly try to answer.
For one question.
Yeah, this is Joe Clark. Keith, I was wondering if, even though the effects are short-term, I noticed mayflies and stoneflies being most affected. Do you think there are implications for the brook trout population that you're trying to restore during that short period of time when they are affected?
It's certainly possible. So the Fisheries Division did they did pull out, there were brook trout in these sites beforehand, but also co-occurring with rainbow trout. So they pulled out as many brook trout as they could. And then after the treatment, they did reintroduce those native brook trout. And they didn't find huge numbers the following year, but they did persist. We did a kind of a side study with this where we looked at gut content of both brook trout and rainbow trout in both of these subwatersheds. And really they were targeting terrestrial inputs much more than aquatic stages. Tree hoppers were one of the most abundant that we found. So yeah, I think it's possible, but based on their opportunistic nature of feeding, maybe not.
Okay, thank you.
We have one question. Question in chat, is antimycin known to bioaccumulate in essence?
As far as I know, no. It does break down fairly quickly. But I don't know how extensively that has been studied either. So great question, something that probably needs to be explored further.